Today, we're gonna finish off the theory part today, at least the heavy theory part. So by Friday, we're gonna be back into proteins, but then we're gonna be looking at real actual protein structures and start to consider what we can do with them, how we can predict, simulate, and really understand biology. So bear with me if you felt that it's far too much equations this far. There's gonna be some equations later on in the course, but we're gonna become way more biological in a couple of days. We spent quite a lot of time yesterday rederiving the Boltzmann distribution for the general case. I spoke about alpha helices. I never had a chance to get to beta sheets. I'm going to repeat the alpha helical part. And I didn't quite forget about your study questions either. But since we're right in the middle of derivations, I didn't really have that many of them. So this is roughly what I had on the very last slide. So let's do a shorter version of the study part, and then I will go through and repeat the complicated, semi-complicated part, at least about alpha helices today. So what are all these letters? Let's start somewhere. What is E? Energy? Yes, and it's particular potential energy or something. I wouldn't call it enthalpy for a specific reason, but that it's energy versus not free energy. Are there any other letters you use for energy? Yes, you can. Since you started, what is H? I just didn't catch it. Enthalpy. Yes. So, what's the difference between enthalpy and energy here? Yeah. So it also includes the part when we're doing work, external work on the system, or that the system is doing external work on the surrounding. That was actually not what I was thinking about when I mentioned that there are other letters. So the problem with, as I've told you a couple of times, what I like with physics is that if you don't know something, you can just define it. And don't be afraid of defining things. Now, in theory, if I ask you to ever derive something, you could, of course, say that you would like to use E for entropy. As long as you made a very clear definition that that's what you're doing, it's perfectly fine. The rest of the world is going to have some major trouble understanding your derivations, but as long as it's very clear you defined, you can use absolutely any letter you want. Now, that's good, but that's also bad. It's good when it's your freedom. It's bad when other people use the freedom. So the problem is that there is a small truckload of different letters that people use for energy in particular. So later on, you will see sometimes we use V, in particular for potential energy. Sometimes we're going to use U to determine an energy. Sometimes you use a small epsilon. Well, it's small, right? It's a small energy. It's just stupid. It would be easier if we all stuck to one letter. But in many of these equations, suddenly you need to account for different energies. And then it's very nice to have a handful of them that you can reuse. That would be good if people just stuck to these letters. As you will see later today, I'm very sorry, but suddenly we're going to use U for free energy. It's just that the book, you need a letter, and then you pick a letter. The solution to this is be very careful about your definitions. And if you want something, define it. Don't assume that E means energy just because you see E in a formula. A very long time ago, I was a PhD student at the Royal Institute of Technology here in Stockholm. And then as a PhD student, you're TA, and you just have to sit down and correct exams. And these physics students, they're pretty smart, and in particular, well, they're pretty smart, but some of them are also pretty lazy. And a typical physics course, there's not that much you have to learn by heart, so they have this gigantic formula books they could have. So this was a course on atomic physics, and in atomic physics, you frequently use the letter Z to mean the atomic number. And this student probably hadn't read that much of the course, but he had this very large formula, so there was some formula where he saw the letter Z. And then he started using his formula until he found the partition function. That yesterday, if you saw the partition function, we used Z for the partition function. So he just happily inserted the partition function everywhere it said Z. That's not entirely stupid, because the formulas are good, right? But be careful with your definitions, because if you had just followed the definitions, you would have said that it was a completely different Z. So that brings us to the other letters. What is S? Entropy. And that is just defined as Boltzmann's constant times the logarithm of the number of microstates. And I know in the book we frequently use V for the microstates. Personally, I like to use omega. Because it's not really a volume, right? V means, well, at least to me, capital V normally means volume. Omega is something you never use anywhere else. Same thing here, you can use absolutely any letter you want as long as you've defined it properly. And then we have F and G that are... So what's the difference between them? Nope. And which one is which?
The F one is just V minus T S to G.
Ha. Normally it is when we define this. But physicists in particular frequently very sloppy. So physicists, both chemists and physicists are sloppy. It's very common in physics, when you actually want to understand the difference, you typically use either F or G. But in many cases in physics, you always use F because you don't really care about pressure. Same thing in chemistry, we always need to take pressure into account, so you use F. So F here too, it's very dangerous. When you see both of the letters, you can assume that G includes the enthalpy, F doesn't. If you just see F, it can be either. So be careful with the definition. I wish that this was more, it comes down to this thing that standards are good, everybody should have their own. So why? And this, so actually, you can answer the other question. Why do we have KB, or the gas constant R? It's very much related to the answer you just had. Yes? Here you mean? No, taking the pressure volume into account would be F versus G, right? So you move from E to H and from F to G. That takes the pressure and volume term into account. But this is different. So Boltzmann's constant, that's really a fundamental, you could say that it's a fundamental natural constant in the sense that it has to do with the scale we've chosen for temperature. So the Boltzmann, the natural way, as we said, temperature comes out naturally as a way, how much does the entropy increase when you're adding energy, right? And that just happens to correspond perfectly to this intuitive concept you all know as temperature. So in physics, the obvious way to do this would be to measure this in terms of energy and always have KB multiplied by T. That would require us to change every single thermometer in the world to have units of energy. It would require us to reteach the entire population what temperature is and say, well, there is no such thing as temperature. This is really energy. That's never going to happen. So in practice, we have to use Boltzmann's constants to be able to translate between temperature as we've known it for several hundred years and the way we thermodynamically derive these things. But that's just the scale constant to translate from kelvins to joules. But then we have this difference R, the gas constant. So all the energies I talk about, I'm sloppy. You're going to be sloppy too. What is the stabilization energy of a hydrogen bond? Sorry? No, the stabilization, sorry. What is the, rather than a stabilization, what is roughly the free energy of a hydrogen bond? Per mole, yes. And you know roughly what a mole is, right? Avogadro's constant. So think about it. The actual energies we're speaking about in biological systems are insanely low. They're like something times 10 to the minus 25 or 23 at least, right? So it would be absurd to always, if we were to work that, you would always need to say, well, my energy is 5 times 10 to the minus 24 or something. Apart from the fact that it would take lots of space, we would keep making mistakes. It's simply pointless. And in the lab, you never go into the lab and say, we added 6,596,000 molecules to the sample. You don't say that. Chemists work with mole. Chemists don't really work with molecules. So the same thing that it makes lots of sense to talk about counting molecules in physics. So in physics, you talk about number of molecules, number of atoms, everything. In chemistry, we prefer to work with moles. And that's, of course, why you use the gas constant. It's basically the Boltzmann constant, and then you include Avogadro's constant in it. But that also means the second we include that, we can start to talk about energies per mole. But do not forget that per mole, right? Because the second you start to say that the stabilization energy of a hydrogen bond is 5 kcal, you're off by a factor of 10 to the power of 23. So energies in these molecular systems are tiny. So how does a system's property, or how does, well, many systems properties, plural, change with energy or temperature? And this question is deliberately a bit fuzzy. What do we mean when something changes with energy? So what property? What is the main property that happens if you increase the energy in a system? Volume, and in particular, the thing we talked about all day yesterday in these curves. Right, and how do they change? Right, so if we're increasing energy, right, there is more ways to divide this energy in the system. And that suddenly means that there will be more microstates in the system that are populated. So the system will be more disordered. Entropy goes up. There are many, all these things basically say the same thing, but there are different ways of formulating it. So higher entropy means that more microstates are populated. There are more ways to divide the energy, etc. So you can think of this, anyway, any toys or something. If you just have two toys, it's difficult to make a mess of them. If you have 10,000 toys, it's very easy to make a mess of them. So what is a phase transition? If you use these formulations in free, with free energy. So there are two parts here. What are phases first? Different states of matter, right? So you can think of either water vapor or liquid water or ice. And if you look at a general phase diagram in physics, you can have pretty much any state under any conditions. Now, the likelihood of having, say, ice at 100 degrees centigrade, it's fairly low, but it's not exactly zero, because now we're thinking in terms of the Boltzmann function, right? Boltzmann distribution. And the reason why some of these are more or less likely, that's, of course, because the free energies of different states vary, right? So phase transitions happen when these curves cross each other. So suddenly, normally you're going to have most of the system by, well, not just most of the system, the vast majority of the system in the lowest free energy state. But suddenly, ice is no longer the lowest free energy state when you're passing 0 degrees centigrade. Water, liquid water would be the lowest free energy state. So it's not really that water changes or that ice changes, but since the free energy of water is smooth, this free energy of ice is smooth. But because they cross, suddenly it's going to be better to move over to the other state. Yes? So let's draw this here. We can say that this is the free energy as a function of temperature. And as the temperature increases, the free energy of, for instance, ice is, you start out low and then you gradually go up, right? Because when you're increasing temperature, it becomes less and less favorable to be in this very ordered state because the entropic term gets worse. But this is smooth all the way, even around 0 degrees centigrade. Water, on the other hand, starts being pretty bad because at low temperature, it's pretty bad to be... at low temperature, water, the disorder in water doesn't really help you, and the hydrogen bond terms are going to punish you. And as we move to higher and higher and higher temperatures, this disordered state becomes better. So if you look at either of these curves, there is absolutely nothing special that happens at 0 degrees centigrade. But the point is that they cross each other, right? So here it's better to be red. Here it's better to be green. And the reason why I keep pushing this simple physical chemistry stuff is that, as you're going to see later today, beta sheets in particular undergo exactly the same type of transitions. So the protein folding, large parts of it really corresponds to phase transitions. It's suddenly better to be in another state. So related to this, what are transition barriers? That's going to be a little bit important. Transition rates and barriers. So what is so what is that? The amount of energy here? That is the right, but that is in particular. So it's asked about two things. Yeah, activation and or the free energy barrier, right? The free energy barrier you need to get over. And how is that related to transition rates? Yeah, so per unit time. So that once you have a barrier, we can somehow calculate or at least estimate what is the time it takes to go over that barrier. But rather than talking about times, it frequently makes much more sense to talk about velocities, that how many molecules per unit of time go over. So the higher the transition rates are, the higher the quicker reactions happen. So what is that determines how fast the reaction happens? Which free energy barrier?
Does it depend on how many barriers there are?
So you said the largest one. Why the largest one?
Because it will be, since the time varies exponentially with the energy barrier,
So you're partly right and partly wrong. So you're certainly right in the sense, if I have a complicated process that has to, you're starting out here, and then you have to go through multiple states, and there is one very high barrier. So if you have to go through barriers sequentially, it's the largest one that's going to dominate completely. But if we go back to my example, if I need to get to the kitchen to get my coffee, there are multiple ways I can get to the kitchen. What determines how quickly this reaction happens? Yes, but the local maximum. In this case, you can argue that in this case, you had one starting point, right? And one pathway to the ending point. It's a single pathway you can take. Assuming now you had a different system here, because this is a gross oversimplification. Remember that real chemistry has hundreds of thousands of dimensions, right? So if I have a starting state here, and then a finishing state here, imagine now if there are lots of different ways I can take here. And this is now not as a function of free energy. You can think of this as some sort of conformational landscape. There are lots of different ways I can take here. And along each of these ways, there would be one barrier there, one barrier there, one barrier there. Which one is going to determine how quickly my reaction happens? Suddenly it's the smallest barrier. Why? Exactly. So that, and the smallest barrier, that's going to correspond to the highest transition rates. So the point is that if there are 10,000 molecules per second that take this path, yes, there might be another 2 per second that takes the next path, but that doesn't really matter, right? In principle, we can sum them all up, but we're going to have the largest transition rate over the barrier that's lowest. So if they are sequential, it's the highest barrier that's most important. If they can occur in parallel, it's the lowest barrier that's going to be important. So this relates to stuff that you already asked about, enzymes. What does an enzyme do?
Catalyze the reaction.
How does the enzyme catalyze a reaction? An enzyme lowers the activation. It lowers the barrier somewhere, right? And suddenly you can, of course, also take the path without the enzyme. That path is still available. But since there is now a lower pathway, since there is now a second pathway with lower barriers, virtually all the molecules is going to take that one instead. We'll come back to enzymes later on. Rather than asking you about the last one here, I will recap and go through the alpha helix kinetics a bit, and then we'll head on to beta sheets. So I spoke where we were yesterday, that I finished a bit quick, the last 10, 15 minutes yesterday, was that we wanted to understand how a helix forms, both what is the stabilization energy of the helices, what are the average properties of the helices, can I somehow connect this to experiment, because all I did yesterday was hand wave. I said, yeah, you'll have to trust me that the stabilization is roughly 2 hydrogen bonds, etc. We have no idea whether that is correct or not. That were rough approximations from me as a physicist. And then I pretty much told you, trust me for now. Today, the point of this comparing to experiments is that we will be able to see, are these roughly correct, or will we have to correct these terms a bit? We will also be able to see how quickly helices form. And this is not going to be correct to more than about one order of magnitude. But as you will quickly learn here, it's the orders of magnitude that are important. If something happens a factor 10 faster or slower, completely pointless. But when things can happen factor 100,000 faster or slower, you start seeing differences. And as you will see in particular, there are some substantial differences between helices and sheets. So one thing I said relatively early on, as much as we talked about phase transitions, helices are actually technically not phase transitions in the physical sense, because phase transitions happens because it's very bad in nature to mix different phases. You end up with a large surface tension between them. Helices are one-dimensional systems, and that means that the so-called surface, the boundary between helix and coil, that's always going to be finite here, and just individual residues. So the helix and coil can coexist. That is, initially, you might think that's bad, but that's wonderful because it makes it so easy to do measurements on helices. So what you do is that you take a small sequence and you put it in a CD spectrometer, and then we change the temperature or the salinity or something, and then we can measure, is it between, what is the fraction of my small sequence that has moved over to helix? Yes? Yeah, so normally what happens in physics, right, is that the point where you've mixed any two phases, say water and ice, that's going to be one of these local maxima, that it's always going to be better for you to move over to more water or more ice, and eventually 100% water or 100% ice, because this mixing is bad. Along the surface, you're neither going to have water nor ice, so you will perturb the hydrogen bonds in that specific case. But when it comes to the helix, if you increase the amount of helix, I'm not increasing the surface area between the helix and coil. Or if I reduce the amount of helix, I'm not changing the area between the helix and coil. So I can adjust the number of helix without really adjusting that energy term at all. And the only reason I need to bring this up, because the point here is that this is not a course on Landau phase transitions and anything. The reason I need to bring this up, because since we've talked so much about phase transitions, the natural way to interpret this is that it's a phase transition, and technically it's not. So just remember that. So yesterday I started talking a little bit about the equations, but you can think about this from the other end. If I want to understand something about a helix, I need to find a way that I can measure things. So you could equally think about this, measuring this from the CD spectroscopy part, right? That I can change some properties and then I can change the amount of helix. But that just tells me that I have 14% helix under some conditions, and that doesn't really help as much to understand it. So I need to find some way to translate the amount of helical residues I have to the stabilization energies, free energies, that we talked about. And what we said yesterday is that there were two terms in this helix, so delta F helix, that corresponded to a delta F init plus the number of residues multiplied by delta F elongation. And I'm well aware that we used small f's yesterday. And what we're interested in is that technically, this initiation term is constant. The way I formulated this yesterday was that the elongation term is roughly constant per residue. This is, of course, not going to be exactly true, because all this will depend slightly on the type of amino acid you have and everything. But to first approximation, there is something that's proportional to the number of residues. And what we are interested in, that if we're now looking at the CD spectrometer, there will be some helices inside the sample, but we don't know exactly how long they are. But what we do know is that at equilibrium, they're going to have their equilibrium length. They don't want to get longer, and they don't want to get shorter. So what I argued a little bit yesterday is that, well, first you can say that at the equilibrium point, that is when this delta F elongation starts to be zero. So at that point, the And the enthalpy we're gaining from the hydrogen bond is, sorry, the free energy we're gaining from the hydrogen bond is exactly the same as the part we're losing in entropy from elongating the helix a bit more. But when we're looking at a real sample of, say, 100 residues or something, I also have to take this part into effect that the helix can start anywhere from residue 1 through 99, actually 1 through 96, because we need at least 4 residues in a helix. And then it can stop anywhere from residue 4 to roughly 100. Same thing here, and if we wanted to, it has, that means that there are roughly 100 by 100 positions where we can A, start, and B, stop a helix, right? There are roughly 100 square positions, 100 square ways of forming a helix here. Technically, we need that factor of 2 to say that it's going to start before it stops. If I wanted to be really accurate here, I should also take into account that they should be at least 3-4 residues long, but that just adds noise, right? We're not interested in the noise. We're interested in the main principles. So the entropy, the number of different ways we can form a helix, really corresponds to Boltzmann's constant times the logarithm of the number of microstates. And here's where I would have used omega. The book uses V, so I will stay with V. But V sounds like a volume, and that has, we're counting different possibilities here. That's not the volume. And then we skip that factor of 2 just to make it simpler. So it's logarithm of n squared, and when that factor 2 is inside the logarithm, we can put it outside the logarithm. So that's roughly 2 times Boltzmann's constant times the logarithm of the length of the entire sequence, including the non-helical part. And then we just know that the delta F helix is that we're going to have an initiation cost. The cost of starting a helix is the initiation cost minus the entropic part here. And then we just start solving a bit here. We know that when the helix doesn't get longer, the delta F of making a helix, that's, if we are at 19 units and if we would like to get to 20, we are just at the point where the helix is no longer, well, the delta F is 0. It's not going to gain us anymore to make it longer. And then it's just a matter of inserting that in the equations we have. You can forget about that part for now. So what this gives us is that the number of residues in the entire sequence, when we have roughly halfway helicity, is just going to be an exponential of this initiation energy divided by 2 kT. We don't know what the initiation energy is. I hand-waved about that yesterday and argued that that was roughly 2 times the stabilization energy of the hydrogen bond. The point here is that this N0 we can measure from the CD spectroscopy. And then we can extract this initiation barrier. So why do I keep hiding this part? Well, for a long time, when in particular in CD spectroscopy, when we measure these things, it makes a lot of sense to, let's see if I had it. No, I didn't have it there. So rather than work with all those long equations, we had these two parameters, sigma and s. We're not really going to repeat them that much, but it's just these are parameters you frequently see. So sigma has to do, both sigma and s has to do with the propensity of different residues to either start forming a helix or extending the helix. But for now, and that's the exact definition. So forget sigma for a second. So the neat thing is that once you know N0, we can calculate either sigma or simply solve for this initiation energy. And of course, this is going to depend on your amino acid. For a common amino acid, this is in the order of a couple of kcals. And that's going to be positive because it's a barrier we need to get over, right? And if that barrier is in the border, in the ballpark of 4 kcals, the free energy of this hydrogen bonds inside helix is in the ballpark of minus 2 kcals per mole. So was I right or wrong yesterday? So I mentioned that this FH was roughly the stabilization energy of a hydrogen bond, right? I was wrong. What's the energy of a hydrogen bond? Ballpark of 5 kcals per mole. So I was off by a factor of 2. Now, considering the amount of approximations we made on the way here, I think this is pretty good. There are a few things that are fundamentally different because of a factor of 2. So why do you think it's 2 instead of 5? What are the things I've ignored? partly that, but in particular, I lied a bit yesterday. I said that a helix, you know what, let's assume that a helix folds in vacuum, right? And then we just get all the energy of the hydrogen bonds. So what this is an indication of any real helix, there will be some hydrogen bonds in the unfolded state. So you're not going to gain quite as much from making the hydrogen bonds in the folded state. But again, anything that's within a factor of two, I'm happy with. In principle, it's the right ballpark. But of course, yes, there were some horrible approximations I made. And that also, once we know that, we can also estimate the entropy we're losing to put one residue in a helical conformation. That's also the ballpark of 2 kcals per mole. And again, this will of course vary a bit for the specific residue. So do you see, the cool part here is that by mixing one dose of experiment and one dose of theory, you can take a super simple measurement and translate something you measured in the lab to a very deep understanding about the properties of molecules. This is even something that's, I wouldn't say impossible, but very hard to calculate in a simulation. And you could understand this by making a $1 experiment with the cheapest piece of equipment we have in the lab almost. And of course, here I'm showing this for protein folding, helix, something, but this comes back into virtually anything you do in chemistry and life science. A large part of research is about attacking a very difficult problem, a problem that you really can't measure straight out. Say that in a sequence machine, right? If you would like to measure what is the sequence, A, G, C, or T, there isn't really any direct adenine measurement, so you can see is it adenine. You're going to need to come up with a simple model based on fluorescence or free energy or something. You need to make a super simple model of, I expect that this would be this way, and then connect it to a measurement. And if this works, you can then go back and say how much, which one of my four bases did I have in this machine. And so virtually all measurements come back to this. You can't just do the measurement, you can't just do the theory, but you need to combine a simple model with measurements. Models should always be simple. You might think that these are dirt, horrible, ugly models because they're so simple, right? There is a famous saying by Wolfgang Pauli, who say you should always simplify as much as possible, but never more. The beauty is in the simple models because they help you understand. Yes?
Like the last point, you're getting the entropy by minus the elongation from the hydrogen bond forming.
Yes. Yeah, sorry, yes, because this, at this point, when the helix doesn't want to get any longer, right?
Yeah.
If what would happen if your elongation energy was still negative? No. Then you would grow the helix, right? So at some point when the helix is happy, the elongation energy will be roughly plus minus zero. And here we're not quite in the beauty, because yesterday I kind of hinted that this should be constant. It's not going to be constant. It will depend a bit. And at some point, you're not going to gain stuff from making the helix any longer. What you can argue, what happens with the helix stability is that the reason why people use these parameters is that depending on what the free energy of elongation is, you're going to have a gigantic shift in the helicity. So, and again, this parameter sigma, depending on what the temperature is, because the temperature also adds in here, if as you're stabilizing the energy of an alpha helix, and do you see there, really, we're talking about units of minus 0.1 to plus 0.1 kT here. So it's extremely small differences in the helicity. So the helicity is really how much this amino acid would like to be in a helix. So that if this, the second this residue starts to slightly prefer to be in a helix, because we have many residues in the helix, you will over roughly 0.2 units of kT, we will go from 0% helix to almost 100% helix. So the helix is an extremely collective property. Either you tend to have mostly coil or you tend to have mostly helix. And this way it kind of looks like a phase transition, but formally it's not a phase transition. It's an extremely cooperative process, but formally not phase transition. Because the width, had this been water for a large system, you would eventually have this as a single point, right? You would be water, 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 and then suddenly it's ice, 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 ice. And here you always have a finite width. But this is, again, why helices are so stable. If most of the residues in your structure prefer to be helical, you will, over a very narrow temperature regime, you will go over to be almost entirely helical. So that's important for your proteins. Otherwise, most of your helices would be kind of floppy. Now, not all molecules have this at minus 2k calorite. So glycine, for instance, doesn't like to be a helix. So you can measure it and show that it's positive, as expected. Proline, on the other hand, you see that it's plus 3 to 5 kcal. That starts to be really horrible. If you're having two prolines after each other, it's pretty much never going to be helix. But you can certainly survive a glycine or two. Alanine is slightly negative. And then you have a couple of large hydrophobic ones that are real negative. In principle, you can use this to predict. Given a sequence, you can use this to predict whether it's going to be helix or not. It's going to be really crappy. Really, really crappy. But this were some of the very first attempts to predict protein structure. Did Arne talk about two Fastman rules in bioinformatics? So at that time, people didn't call it bioinformatics. So at that time, people started to look at experimental properties of amino acids, both the how much they like to be in a helix, how much they like to be in a beta sheet, and how much they like to be in turns. And based on this, again, just simple measurements of them, you could then, for an arbitrary sequence, try to predict whether it should be helix sheet. This was a tremendous advance in the 60s, 70s, because you got like probably 40, 50% accuracy on your secondary structure determination. But this was really the first time you could use paper and pen, or at least a computer, to predict what the structure should be. So why are you so much better today in bioinformatics with your predictors? Where do you get your more information from? And you cheat, right? You cheat by looking at actual proteins and evolutionary information. So this is the problem, that in principle, all the information is there in physics, but if you only look at one helix at a time, you're not going to get all the contributions from the surrounding helices. And that's why, in practice, you're going to need to look at the entire protein. So if we move on, but that was just the stability. So if you then move on to the kinetics, and I'm going to argue that helices form super fast, ballparks of hundreds of nanoseconds for a small typical segment. And that means that each helical residue you're adding, you're talking 5 nanoseconds might be a bit fast, but say well below 100 nanoseconds at least. So this is so fast that you can see helices grow in simulations. No problem whatsoever. Well, we kind of know what this is, right? Because we went through the whole theory of barriers yesterday. The barrier should be proportional to some sort of time constant multiplied by the exponential of the free energy barrier divided by kt. And we know roughly what this free energy barrier is now, because that's what we measured in the last few slides. So if I look at a particular position, say position one, the time I would expect it to take to go across this barrier is going to be some sort of time constant. We have no idea what this is, but it's some time that represents just the time it would take to move across the barrier if you had enough energy. And then an exponential of the free energy barrier divided by kt. And again, you can forget the sigma if you want, but we know that this has, you could also say that this tau times the exponential of roughly minus 2 kcal per mole divided by kt, right? But here it becomes convenient just to use the sigma parameter. But for a long sequence, you don't have to start in position one. You can start in the middle of the helix and then grow the helix to both sides. So that the number of places we can start the position is basically roughly the number of residues in the entire sequence, right? The first approximation. And we knew from the last slide, two slides ago, that you could also relate to this one over the sigma parameter. Or if you don't like sigma, this expression. So it turns out that the time it takes to initiate the helix anywhere is roughly going to be this tau, and then, well, you can say the exponential of f in it divided by 2 kT, or again, if we like to use the sigma, it's going to be something like that. And then if we're now going to need to propagate this to all residues, let's just assume that it will take roughly the same, if we assume that it's going to be the first approximation, the same time, but then we now have to do this for all residues. That too I can translate to this sigma parameter. And again, the only reason for using this sigma is to avoid using this long exponential expression everywhere. If you do this math and compare them, you will see that for a normal helix under this approximation, you're going to spend roughly half the time to start it somewhere and roughly half the time to extend it. The main take-home lesson there is that helices, they start to form super quick. The barrier, the initiation barrier, there is an initiation barrier, but it's low. It's almost so low that you, it's so low that you hardly see it. You could almost see helices grow, not quite, but. And that also means for large proteins take time to fold. Helices are typically not going to be the time limiting factor for protein folding. They will, if things are happy in a helix, they boom, they will form a helix right away. So to sum up the helices, they form super quick. Both initiation and elongation matters for the time because they form so quickly that we're not going to be entirely dominated by initiation barrier. It's possible to determine all these energies from very simple CD spectra. The free energy barriers we're talking about is 1 kcal might be a bit optimistic, but not more than a handful of kcal. So less than the free energy of a hydrogen bond, which means that there is hardly any bump at all for a helix to start forming. And what this N0 matters is that already here we can start to see there's going to be a characteristic length of helices somewhere around 20, 30 residues at equilibrium, just based on measurements. We will come back to this and prove this more formally, why 20, 30 residues are going to be the most stable length of helices. Did you have a question? Or? So let's see. We did this in two ways, right? What I did the last few things is I said that there is some sort of initiation barrier and there is some sort of elongation barrier. And then I said that what are the stabilizing parts and what are the destabilizing parts? So the stabilizing parts would be the hydrogen, primarily the free energy corresponding to the hydrogen bonds. And then the parts that were purely a loss were the loss in entropy because I'm forcing residues to become helical. So in that case, the barrier will have to come from the fact that early on, the thing that cost you free energy to form an alpha helix is always going to be entropy. But the difference here is that initially on, you're only paying that cost, but we're not gaining anything back from hydrogen bonds. So it's not until we've formed like 3 or 4 turns that we actually start getting some hydrogen bonds that will favor it. Now, to make it slightly more complicated, that doesn't mean, so there, the part that costs you is virtually only entropy. But the part where you gain stuff, the hydrogen bond, that's a bit of a mix, right? Because hydrogen bond forms, in particular when we take something from water where you already have hydrogen bonds, and move it to the inside of a protein where we're just redistributing hydrogen bonds. So the hydrogen bond formation itself contains both entropy and enthalpy. And now I realize I probably confused you more, right? This gets super complicated if you try to look at each and every individual term in the free energy. So think about this hierarchical part. So when I talk about the alpha helices, and we're going to do this for beta sheets now, which will be another, even slightly more complicated than the alpha helices, then we don't really care that much about energy versus entropy anymore. So now I just talk about the free energy. What is the free energy of starting something? What is the free energy of extending it? Now, each of these free energies will internally have both enthalpy and entropy parts, but when I just thinking about the barriers, I try not to worry too much about the details. So that was alpha helices. Should we try to do this for beta sheets? The funny thing is that if you look at beta sheets, it's not just that they can take 10 or 100 times longer than alpha helices. they can take millions of times longer to fold. It can take hours to weeks to form a small beta sheet. So there is something that's fundamentally different from alpha helices here. And that's what we would like to understand. This is not merely a matter of understanding physical chemistry for low structures. This, as I'm going to tell you in a couple of slides, turns out to be critical for a lot of diseases. There are lots of diseases in the body that appear to be related to beta sheet folding and misfolding. And it's very much related to the kinetics. And in other cases, beta sheets will fold in a millisecond, almost as quick as an alpha helice. We don't know why. So the first question that we need to ask ourselves is, there is some sort of, if something is slow, there are going to be some barriers involved here, right? Can you say something about the barriers just by comparing these two, that it can sometimes take a millisecond and sometimes weeks? You can't. That's a rhetorical question, but what can we say about it? So what can I say about the activation energy? Yes, I would say that they're higher in beta sheets because alpha helices could fold in a fraction of a microsecond or so. But if it's sometimes very fast and sometimes very slow, what more can I say about the activation energy? It's going to be a very large range of activation energies for beta sheets. So we need to understand why they're sometimes gigantic and sometimes relatively low. I'm also going to, again, the beta sheets actually appears to be a formal phase transition. It's going to be all or nothing. So what happens when we fold things in beta sheets? If you avoid looking ahead at the next few slides, how would you try to understand beta sheet folding if I asked you, if you had no idea? How did we approach the alpha helix? So you can measure the fraction of beta sheet in something roughly how you did with CD spectroscopy. So I'm not going to go too much into the experiments here, but alpha helices, in a way, that was a trivial process because we just had our small helix, right, and we kept adding to the helix. One of the big questions is how do beta sheets form, right? What are the intermediate states? What happens on the way? And if you want to understand kinetics, what can we say about the kinetics? Well, you said that there had to be some barriers involved, right? So let's see, there has to be some sort of initial state here. I will approximate things and say that there is just one large barrier here and then some stable state. Why am I drawing just one barrier? And in particular, all or nothing, as I spoke about yesterday and in the recap this morning, when can I approximate things with one barrier? One path, or in particular, there's likely going to be one barrier that is the rate limiting step, right? So let's, in practice, there's going to be hundreds of small barriers, but let's try to focus on the main barrier. Now, could you imagine many ways of forming a beta sheet? Actually, we could, right? You could imagine having some starting and end state, and there are lots of different potential paths between them. But in that case, I will try to pick the path that is the best one. So first we pick the path that is the best one, because the first approximation, I can ignore the other ones, right? We're going to see most of the flux there. Once I have the barrier that is the best one, then we start looking at, okay, so this barrier is going to be the lowest of all different paths. So what is the lowest barrier what is the main barrier along the lowest path? And that is the barrier we want to understand. And if I can characterize how high this is going to be, then I will understand how quick or slow they will form. So in principle, at this point, you should bring out paper and pen and start to sketch a couple of different beta sheets and try to guess what would happen and what would the different states be here. So what would these states correspond to? Well, here you're going to have a full beta sheet, right? Here's where we want to get. That's the trivial one. This one is something that's completely unfolded. But what is that? What do we have there at the peak of the barrier?
The second one.
Well, forget about that plot for a second. In general, what type of states are these? So it's a transition state. And what do we mean by a transition state? Is it a good or a bad state? How bad is it? In practice, you can never measure that. This is pretty much the absolutely worst state you will ever go through on the path there, right? So we're interested in finding the worst possible state along the best path. And here is where your intuition will come in a bit. We need to think about the ways a typical beta sheet will form. From the start, you have to accept this is not going to be exact. This will be a model. Now, how good or bad your model is can only be assessed one way. And what is that? How do you determine if your model is good or bad? Will it have predictive value? Will you be able to learn important things from it? There is not necessarily any, at the end of the day, you could say that, hey, we should just throw all this in a computer and simulate it exactly. Then you will get the answer, but you won't necessarily get the understanding. So the beauty of a simple model is to get your understanding. So that if we have a beta sheet, if we just look at a beta sheet here, at some point, we're going to need to start to form the beta sheet somewhere along the sequence. And eventually, you can have a very, very large beta sheet, and then it will hopefully be stable. We know that they have to be stable because you can see them experimentally. But the interesting thing is usually what happens when you start to form something, when you have just one hairpin. So if you have one strand and one turn and one more strand, that's what we call a beta hairpin. It's somewhere there that's going to be the start of a real helix, right? It's not necessarily going to be exactly there. So there are some things that are good and bad here. We will come back to them slightly later on. So the point is that we want to find the part here where we keep paying. It gets worse and worse and worse and worse. And then see, can we at least estimate that roughly what this state would correspond to and estimate what are the free energy parts that contribute positively and negatively to this state? And as some of you might have read in the book, that's going to be roughly here. So we've formed a hairpin and we've formed a second turn, but we haven't started adding more residues. I will motivate that in a second, why that's good or bad. So if we compare sheets to alpha helices, one key difference is that they're two-dimensional. So they have both the length right and the width. Fundamentally different from helices. The interface area grows with the number of residues, and the interface area, you can think of that as the unpaired hydrogen bonds. Say, those hydrogen bonds don't have partners to the right, and those residues don't have any partners to the left. So there is some part here where these residues have beta sheets on the inside, but not on the outside, and the same thing there. And the more residues we put here, the larger we make the beta sheet, the larger that area is going to be. And you will also have some residues here that have an interface with the surrounding. And if you're like the physics wonky part here, that actually means that suddenly you're in more than one dimension, and then phases can't coexist. And that's why you're going to have a phase transition. But what this means is that we're going to need to start to look a little bit about these. What are the things when we interact with the surrounding? What happens at the edges of these sheets, and what happens in these bends or the turns you make between two strands? Yes?
I have a question. When you say two-dimensional, I mean technically they're both three-dimensional.
Technically everything is three-dimensional, but in the way we're working with the model, right? An alpha helix, you can even an alpha helix is three-dimensional, right? But on the model stage, when determined, is a residue in alpha helix or coil? If you're just looking along the sequence, that's a one-dimensional property. Even though the atoms itself, if you look at the entire amino acids, on a low level, it's three-dimensional. So this all has to do with the scale you're looking at. A famous example in physics would be if you just have a very thin line. A line is one-dimensional, right? So an ant walking along a line, that would be a one-dimensional process. But if you now magnify this, this line might really be a rope or something. And if you magnify it enough to the ant, this is going to appear to be three-dimensional. So it's all a matter of how much you magnify it. So a protein would be three-dimensional, the entire tertiary structure. The secondary structure for an alpha helix would be one-dimensional, beta sheet two-dimensional. And the sequence is always one-dimensional. But it's just a model. And again, the point here is not the main physics, but trust me that this will have properties as if it was a phase transition. So let's look a little bit at these sheet edges and bends and what happens there. And here's where this can appear super complicated, but I would actually argue this is very easy. What do you do if you don't know anything about something? You start to define things, right? And how lucky or unlucky we're going to be, that depends a little bit on how you make your definitions. If you make good definitions, things are going to be easy. In this case, it's going to turn out you can define these things pretty much any way you want. It's not going to be a gigantic difference in simplicity. But rather, I think I would confuse you if I defined this in a different way from the book. So I will try to follow the book. So there are not that many things we have to consider. Just as in an alpha helix, if you're moving something from a stretched out coil into a secondary structure, that's a more well-ordered state. So that's in general going to cost us. But now we will stick to what I said 5 minutes ago. Let's not worry about the specific details, differences between enthalpy and entropy here. Let's think in terms of free energy. So for now, to make your life simpler, let's not even worry about the sign. If I have a residue and move that from a stretched out coil and put it in beta sheet state, there will be a difference in free energy, just for the change in flexibility. That's going to be the same whether it's on a sheet whether it's on the edge of a sheet or whether it's on the inside of a sheet, to first approximation at least. So let's just call that something. The book calls it F beta, the free energy of putting a residue inside a beta hairpin, so that is now in stretched out conformation. We're not going to worry about the sign for now. It's a definition. But then there is, of course, a substantial difference whether something is on the edge or not. Sorry, I'm going to need to go back. So once you're inside here, all these black residues, they will have a hydrogen bonds both to the left and to the right, right? But anything that's on an edge here will only make one hydrogen bond. It doesn't matter whether it's just two strands or three strands. The residues here that are on the first and last beta strand, there will be a difference there. They will have one hydrogen bond less. And again, we're not going to worry about the specific entropy or enthalpy of hydrogen bonds, but there will be some difference there. You could call that F edge if you wanted to. You can define it to anything. The book likes to call it delta F beta because it's a small extra change. So that's the extra difference in free energy you get when you are at an edge. So for any residue, when we move it to a beta sheet, it's going to have F beta. And the ones that are on edge will also have delta F beta. And again, at this point, it's just definitions. We don't know anything about it. So the residues inside will have F beta, and the residues that are on these edges of the sheets, their free energy difference will now be F beta plus delta F beta. Do you follow me that far? Just definitions. And the other part we're going to need to take these turns into account. Whether it's called this bend or turns or something, doesn't really matter. But there will be, I think you agree with me, there will be some difference for the residues here. Whether that is because they're making fewer hydrogen bonds or because the entropy is different, let's not worry about the details. We would just say that this residue here, well, it's not the same thing as if it's inside. But that is probably similar to that, is probably similar to that. So for those residues that are part of this one, let's say that there is some sort of free energy for it. And whether that is one, two, or three residues, I don't really care. But for every such turn I need to make, there will be some free energy of making that turn. Right now, I don't care about the sign. There is a free energy. We might or might not be able to measure it, but there is a free energy that corresponds to the turn. So I just define that as U. And here you see the problem with physicists and their definitions. In many cases, you would use U for an energy, and here we use U for a free energy. Live with it. People will do that all the time. People will define things in ways that are not what you would define it as. In this case, the book has made their definition, so let's follow their definition. And now, I and the book argue the last part here. Since beta sheets form, we must have the delta F beta must be larger than zero and U must be larger than zero. So this is the next step. I'm not at all asking that you should take this for granted. So let's, because the second you've made your definitions, right, you can sit down and try to reason about them. Do we know anything about our definitions? And I'm arguing that we know these two things. So if I'm claiming that something must be the case, what is the best way of proving that this is true? Right, so in mathematics that you would call it reductio ad absurdo. So that assume that the opposite is true and show that that leads to a ridiculous statement, or that it would lead not compatible with what we can measure. So let's, I think the U one is easier. What would happen if the free energy of making bends was negative? Right, so in that case, all your sheets, you would just be making bends, right? All the way. The more bends, the better. Why on earth should you even bother with a beta sheet? Just make more turns all the time. We don't see that in structures. So in general, that can't be true. I'm sure there could be one exception where it is true, but in general, sorry, that won't happen. So we must be paying to make, the turns itself can't be good. So we just, and now we just learned something. So one of our definitions, we've now said that that one must be positive. I'm also saying that the delta F beta must be larger than zero. And there I will try, can we try to make that reasoning? So what was delta F beta first? Sorry? Right, so the delta F beta is basically the difference we would have when you are in a single strand instead of two strands, right? So if delta F beta was negative, it would always be better to be on the outside of a sheet. In that case, you would never ever have any residues on the inside of a sheet. And in that case, you would just have one long beta strand. You would never ever, because we just said that turns weren't good either, right? We don't see that in proteins either. It doesn't happen. So that, and again, for an individual residue, it can be true, but it can't be true for beta sheets in general. So let's not worry about special cases, but focus on the general things. So that's good. That means that we know a little bit about the things that we have. We can, so now we know something about delta F, and we know something about U. Can we say something about F beta? The free energy for a residue to be on the inside of a beta sheet. So dare to speak up. There's nothing bad, actually. Being wrong is a great thing. You should be wrong, because that means you're having ideas. So what would happen if F beta always is negative? And remember, I'm not talking about a specific residue, but I'm talking for any residue. Then we would, every single residue would always like to be beta sheet. Beta sheet would always be better than coil. Is that generally true? No, because there are some residues that don't like to be beta sheets. On the other hand, if F beta was always positive, we would never see any beta sheets. So the problem, and the reason I bring this up is that it's not always that you will be able to make these types of assumptions. Sometimes you will, and sometimes you won't. So apparently we can't say anything about F beta. That can have any sign. The third part, though, is that the free energy at these edges, we might be able to say something about F beta plus delta F beta. And I would argue that there are two scenarios here. Either they're larger than zero or smaller than zero. They could be exactly zero too, but we don't really worry about that. That's just a single point. So let's think about what this means. If F beta plus delta F beta was smaller than zero, that would mean that as long as I, being in a beta sheet together with being at the edge is good, as long as we make a single turn, one large hairpin that, like, the longer it is would be good. because the residues are inside the beta sheet. They're also at the edge. So for all these, it would be positive. As long as I can make one turn, this would be awesome. Well, that might happen in proteins. If you look at the protein data bank, you will occasionally see structures where there's just a beta hairpin. It can happen, not impossible. The other possibility is that just for a single residue, being in a beta sheet but also being at the edge is not really good. And that would mean that the hairpin itself, this is not really good. We kept paying. Forming the entire first hairpin is bad, and it's only when we start adding the third strand here so that we start having these residues that are fully on the inside of the protein. It's not really until we start forming the third one that it starts to be good again. Both of these can be possible. If you're going to look at beta sheets and we want to understand why beta sheet formation can be so slow, which one of these processes is going to be the slowest, the most difficult to form beta sheets for? The second one, right? Because at this point, the second you form the hairpin is good. And here we have formed the hairpin, but even the entire hairpin itself is bad. And this is where you get to the point we had in the book. So you need to have one entire beta strand. Then we need to have a turn. Then we need to have one entire second beta strand. It's still bad. I'm going to need to have a second turn. The turns are self, we said that U is positive, right? So that this is also bad. And finally, when I start adding the first residue here, now I start to have some residues on the inside. So that to first approximation, the worst possible state I'm going to have here, which is likely the transition state, is going to be something like this. Two entire strands and two turns. This is a model, a guess. There are some things that I've ignored there and everything. But let's try to work with that and see where that gets us. So the free energy of this worst possible state would then be, well, we have some sort of turn. N here would be number of residues in each strand. And all residues, they are in a beta sheet, and they're also along the edge because we just have one long turn. Sorry, I'm jumping a little bit ahead here. This is not there. When I'm gonna get that first. On the next slide, I'm gonna go through and actually determine the free energy rate. The problem here is that we're going to need to know for a hairpin or this, in general, how long should the helix here be? Because we're going to need to know that. What is the smallest length when they start to be stable? Because if n here was zero, then I would only have turns. But I don't want n to be infinity either, right? So we're going to need to determine how long they should be. So there will be a small extra proof here. How do we determine how long this is? Well, we can calculate what the free energy of each of these parts is, right? And as long as the free energy is good, that it's going to be longer and longer and longer. At some point, when the difference is plus minus zero, that's going to be the smaller. At some point, we initially just pay. Because if you make it longer, we pay. And at some point, you're going to get the smallest length where they're actually stable. Because the part we are gaining from the inside here is the same as the part that we lost from the turn. Yes? I haven't made the second turn yet. I will come back to that in a second. Sorry, it was me that I skipped the part of it here. I'll make that derivation board carefully. What I want to get at eventually, I want to determine what that transition state is. And I'll skip one slide ahead. To determine what this transition state is, I'm going to need to calculate what is the cost of having one full strand here, one turn, one more full strand, and one turn. That's exactly where we want to get at. The only problem to determine that, I know that I have two turns, but the question is, how many residues do I have in each strand, right? The number of residues here is going to influence what the free energy is, and we don't know that yet. If this is just two residues, or is it going to be 200 residues, that will in general influence how large the beta sheets are going to be and how easy it's going to be to fold them. So I was a little bit too quick here. To be able to say how large this free energy barrier is, we first need to determine, well, what is the smallest length of these strands where they actually like to form beta sheets? So then we go back one step. Before we can get to the transition state, we're going to need to determine how long do hairpins want to be. So if you just look at one hairpin, there is some sort of length here, and we're interested in the smallest length when the hairpin starts to be stable. And the main difference here we have one full strand there, one full strand here, but we only have one turn. So we have the turn is U, and then we have two times the length of, so the number of residues we have in each strand, and the part that it's beta sheet and the parts that they are at edges. So both of them are at edges, so we can group that together. So what's going to happen if we now keep extending this beta sheet? For every strand I'm adding here, I would add one turn and one strand, right? And the second time I would add one turn and one strand, one turn and one strand, one turn and one strand. So for this to be possible to happen, the free energy here of one turn plus one strand has to be at least zero. If I were to pay here, I would never form beta sheets. And in general, I only pay for the turn, so I need to gain something back from the strand here. But the problem is if the strand here is too short, I'm not going to gain enough to counter the part I paid for the turn, right? So there has to be some sort of minimum length to the beta sheet or they can't be stable. Do you follow that? So if I now extend this, and this is where the beautiful definition helps me, that I still have exactly the same number of residues in edges, because I still have one edge to the left and one to the right. So I don't need to worry about that. So what happens when I'm adding one more strand here is that I'm taking n residues and putting them in beta sheet. So that was this energy F beta, my definition. Now, if you had made another definition, you would end up with a difference here or something. That works fine too. It's not the end of the world. It's just that this is slightly nicer. And I also know that the cost here of making that turn, well, that was the cost U. So the case here, the smallest length I can allow here, that really has to do that the cost, what we're paying for the turn, should be equal what we're gaining back from the strand. So the smallest number, U should then be equal to minus N F beta. So the smallest n I can allow is when u, that's u, the energy, the free energy of the turn, divided by minus the free energy of putting something in a helix. The signs here just had to do with how we designed the signs of the various components originally.
Sorry, can you say that again? I don't quite follow.
So what I'm saying here is that the case where the free energy is at least plus minus zero here, that's the first case when I will be able to add one of these. So I'm interested in what is the smallest length here, the smallest n here that would allow this to be at least plus minus zero. Now, if you make n even larger here, it would be very negative. That's fine too, but I'm after the smallest length that we can allow. So in the smallest length we can allow, that would be when the total delta F would be plus minus zero. So the part I'm paying, and notice I'm not talking about energy versus entropy now, but there is one part that I'm just paying. I'm paying the free energy of the turn, and I'm gaining back the free energy of putting them in beta sheet. So in this case, F beta would have to be negative. Why? Otherwise, these residues wouldn't like to be a beta sheet in the first place, right? But that's also why we end up with the extra minus sign here. Otherwise, the number of residues would be negative at the end. So when these two are equal, I just think U equals minus N F beta. And that means that in the case where that is exactly plus minus zero, if U equals N multiplied by minus F beta, I can solve for what the number of residues is in that case, so just by divide both terms with minus F beta. So the smallest number of residues that this is stable for is the energy of the turn divided by minus the free energy of putting the residue on the inside of a helix. That's just pure mathematics, very simple formula. I just say that that equals that. Delta F prime equals delta F bis. So all that gives me is this extra help we needed. Now we have an expression that what is the smallest length of the beta sheets when this can happen? So did you follow that? It's a model, it's an estimate, but now I know roughly how long the parts can be. So now I can get back to what we were really after, identifying this transition state. So we're going to use the formula on the last slide in a second, but if you now believe me that the worst possible state on the way to forming something larger, that's going to be when we have one strand, one turn, one strand, one turn. So that's going to correspond to the energy of making the first turn. And then we have the two strands, and that's two number times the number of residues in the strand, F beta plus delta F beta plus the second turn. So why is it important to have n min here? Why couldn't I just have any n? Exactly, right? Because that this might very well happen for a much larger n2, but that would be a higher barrier. We're only interested in the lowest barrier because that's what's going to dominate the time. That there are other secondary barriers that are even higher, we could not care less. And the book actually then goes into quite some effort to prove that this is the lowest possible transition state. And that's just because if there was some other even lower energy barrier, then it could happen even faster. This is a general problem when you're working with transition states. Unless you can prove that something is the lowest state, all you can hope for is that you found the lowest state. But what that means that if there is an even lower state that we ignored, that just means that the process will happen even faster. So this will just prove that it can happen fast. But then we know a couple of things from the last slide. We know that U was equal to minus N min F beta, right? That's what we derived on the last slide. So we have one U there and one U there, and we have N min there. It's kind of irritated to have this N min because there should be number of residues. That's going to be virtually impossible to measure. So what we would like to do here is kind of try to get rid of the N min. So what you do is you use this formula twice. So first we have N min equals U minus F beta. Well, that means that we can take that N min and replace it with a U, right? And then we use the formula once again. And if you use the formula twice, you can actually show that you end up with this expression. Not super difficult mathematics. So once you remove that N, that means that the free energy barrier here, that's a function of, well, what is it a function of? Let's see. So it matters on the energy of the turn. If we increase the energy of the turn, we're going to increase the barrier. If we increase the energy, this delta energy that we had on the sides, then it's also going to be slower. That also makes sense, because if it's really, really bad to be in this hairpin state, this free energy barrier is going to be higher. But then in the denominator, we had this, what is the stability energy of being in a beta sheet? So the lower that one is, then this term is going to increase in magnitude. And that means that the free energy barrier goes down. Does that make sense? Right, so the more things like to be in beta sheets, the faster this process will be. But the worse the transition states is, the slower it will be. Can you say something about this already at this point? Is this an easier or more complicated relation than it was for an alpha helix? Well, for an alpha helix, we ended up with an expression saying that the free energy barrier was roughly this initiation barrier, right? And the initiation barrier varied between, say, minus 2 to plus 3 to 5 kcals per mole. So for an alpha helix, this did not really vary a lot. This is going to vary a lot. And that was kind of what we were after when it came to understanding why beta sheets could be so, have a remarkably broad spectrum of errors. So let's do the calculations. You know this. There is going to be some sort of time constant. We don't care about that. And here's where you're going to see that it makes a lot of point that we don't worry about it. And then there's going to be an exponential raise to plus this free energy barrier. It's roughly the same thing here. You can initiate the beta sheet anywhere. And in this case, it's going to turn out that the initiation is entirely time limited. And the reason for that is that this F hash, the free energy transition state, if you start to have a very good stabilization barrier here because it occurs in the denominator, you're going to take the free energy barrier down to almost nothing right away. Same thing here. If this starts to become very small or even have the opposite sign, this one will grow almost without limits. So you're going to have a very, very strong exponential relation that's some sort of constant. We don't care that much about that constant because that constant is going to be the turn and the edges. But because this now occurs in the denominator in the exponential, if the stability here is good, you're going to form in no time whatsoever. If the beta sheet stability starts to be bad, it's literally going to take you forever before this forms. So compared to alpha helices, that's also why I could hand wave and say that the residue doesn't really matter. It's a couple of milliseconds, well, up to a microsecond, maybe a millisecond, but it's fast. The only question for alpha helices is whether it's fast or super fast. For beta sheets, all bets are off. You can easily have a handful of residues that don't want to be in a beta sheet, and then this can take weeks. This means that if a sheet is If sheets are completely unstable, they wouldn't form at all, right? But if sheets are marginally stable, that the total free energy of the entire sheet is just so slightly below zero, this can take almost forever before the beta sheet forms. And this makes them very hard to do experiments on, even in the lab. It's hard to say, have we reached equilibrium? Have they formed yet? Yes?
If it's so not stable and takes so long, why would they want to be formed?
So that's what I said, that when I was a bit sloppy here. If they literally are unstable, it wouldn't form. But if they're weakly stable or marginally stable, that means that the total free energy is just so slightly below zero, they will still form, but they will take forever to form. For alpha helices, it's a bit different. If alpha helices are just so marginally stable, they would still form very quickly, but they would likely unfold too. So for alpha helix, so here you see the difference between barriers and troughs in the free energy landscape. Both for an alpha helix and a beta sheet, you would have a delta G that can go. If it's an alpha helix, you would start out here, and then you would have some sort of barrier, and it would be lower there, and that pen sucks. For an alpha helix, you would start out there having some small barrier, and then be better to be in the alpha helix. For a beta sheet, you could have something like this too, or you could have it look like that. So the free energy difference here can be very small in both cases. For an alpha helix, what would happen? They would still form fast, but they would also unfold relatively fast. What would happen for a beta sheet is that you would start out here, it would take forever for you to fold. Once you have folded, though, you can be super stable, because it would also take you even more forever to unfold. So here is an example that the free energy difference between the stable states is the same. But the free energy barriers that determine the kinetics, how fast it happens, are vastly different. And here you start entering into some philosophical questions. If this takes 4 weeks, it will still happen, right? If it would take 400 years, would it still happen? Well, technically it would in the lab, but the problem in your body, you would die before it happens. So does that mean it can happen? You can't really define it, right? So normally when we speak about stability, and that's why I actually wrote down stable here. So normally when you speak about stability, you think of thermodynamic stability, equilibrium. That means that this is a more stable state than that one. Stability only, if you're a physicist, thermodynamics, you're only looking at the world at equilibrium, you only care about the local minima in free energy. Thermodynamics, stability, it's a beautiful world, it's simple. You only have to care about the Boltzmann factors for all the local minima. The problem is, at equilibrium, we're all dead. So in practice, we're going to need to care about kinetics. And you can also think of things in terms of kinetic stability, then barriers are so high that in practice you can't get over them. Because if this barrier is so high that would take you 400 years, you could effectively say that you're stable here too, right? Because you would never ever have enough energy to go across the barrier. Because that corresponds to walking straight through a wall. So you can talk about both terms of stability, and we very frequently do. And this is actually a great example, because I wasn't intentionally sloppy here. When I say unstable sheets here, that's sheets that don't really appear to want to form in practice. So here I use the concept in terms of kinetic stability. And the problem is we need to account for both. So if you want to, you can compare helices and sheets a little bit more. I'm not going to really focus too much on these phase transitions. Again, if you're a physicist, this is kind of fun, but I want to head on to talk about real biology, and we should have a break here in a second. So the differences in this folding head is that alpha helices end up having much longer barriers that they can overcome very quickly. The free energy of beta sheets is not just a physical fun idea. So here we actually start getting into disease. This is super important for lots of things, in particular this kinetic stability. And that's the last slide I want to show you before the break. That we know nowadays that there is a fairly large number of proteins that are diseased called by protein misfolding. This is very strange when we first saw it. So anything you know, gut feeling, based on last semester at KI, how does disease happen? There are two traditional ways you get disease. External factors. Yeah, but forget about prions. I think in the old beautiful world before we know about this thing, there were viruses and bacteria, right? They're all the only two disease agents we have. Either it's a virus or a bacteria, and when you get a new disease, the first thing to determine, is it a bacterial infection or is it a virus? And what happened some 20 years ago, it was really scary, that you started to see a first couple of handful of examples of disease that led to very severe neurological diseases, and there was some sort of infectious agent that we couldn't identify. Can you imagine that, again, because this is based on over 100 years of experience, that we know what the infectious agents in nature are, and suddenly there's a new infectious agent. Even if you heated it to 100 degrees centigrade, you frequently didn't destroy it. So the amount of scare we had, the entire world had, because if there is something new, is it something new type of virus or bacterium that we can't identify, that would basically uphold everything that we know about life science. And what Stanley Prusiner and a bunch of people were able to prove that this is what led to the entire, well, what they then termed Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease, and what became much more famous as the mad cow disease. is that this has to do with misfolding of proteins, proteins that appear to have two stable states. And this two stable states really corresponds to these very high free energy barriers, that you have proteins that normally would be in one state. You could even say that this is the state where they that's biologically active, but this state might not be the lowest free energy. It's just the lowest free energy in the sense that it would be stable here for 100 years. So what's the problem? We're perfectly stable here. We can't ever get across that barrier. That means you can ignore that state, right? Because you're kinetically stable. But what if somebody who doesn't want you well created a catalyst? So what if instead of the green path, you could now take a blue path here that had a much lower free energy barrier? That doesn't require energy. The catalyst doesn't use energy. Just some way you get rid of that really bad free energy barrier. Suddenly you would move over to this state. And if that is now a disease state when your proteins don't work, well, that's going to be pretty bad. And in particular, if that state can't even be degraded by your body because it's super stable, you can't really unfold the proteins and recycle them. This appears that all, and we know that this happens for a number of proteins today, they are all related to beta sheets. So what happens is that somehow, one way or another, when you have more of these beta sheets available in your body, they appear to catalyze the expansion of more beta sheets. Exactly this way. And that leads to misfolding of proteins. And this is a gross oversimplification, but the problem is that because you can't degrade these proteins, what now if you take, this probably happens in your body all the time, but it's a very small fraction of your proteins that undergo this. And again, sorry to say it, but in 100 years, you're all going to be dead. So it doesn't really matter if you have a small buildup of these proteins. If it's 0.01% of your protein population, it's not going to influence how your brains work because you will be dead before it happens. But of course, if this happens naturally in your body and you can't degrade it, what now if you take these parts of the body and feed it to another animal? These proteases, they're what you have in your stomach to degrade amino acids. So suddenly these beta sheets or plaques can't be degraded. And now you get these, by the time you're 20 or 30, you start having a relatively large population of these misfolded states that in turn will catalyze more misfolded states. And suddenly you will start building up these plaques faster and they will hit you when you're 40, 50. And that was the entire origin of the mad cow disease, that they fed cows cow brains. Very bad idea. There are a bunch of other diseases, kuru, for instance, if cannibals and everything. It's bad to eat brain. It's probably legal too, but it's not just this, but that we know that there is a lot of debate today, but we know that there are a large number of diseases where you end up having these plaques that appear to be all beta sheets. Having said that, in a beautiful, simple world, it should only be, we think that these plaques are causing the disease. There is, unfortunately, increasing evidence now that they might just be a side effect in lots of diseases like Alzheimer's. So that they're important, but we don't know what they do. But it's definitely related to protein misfolding. It's one of the really big unsolved classes of diseases in the world. Yes? So I'm not sure I followed that question again. So you had many of the proteins and they form in these misfolded states.
Yeah.
And your question was?
Like, wouldn't we at one point, like, we can, like, have some sort of protease that may be able to?
You might be able to, but the problem is if this is a very, this might not be a good example. You can imagine if you take this green curve and extend it all the way down here, is that right? If this is now a super stable, awesome state, it would cost you a lot of energy to move this up across this barrier. My gut feeling is that the protein, we might be able to digest a small part of them, but not enough. The proteins are too stable. And this comes back to the thing that I've talked about before. From an evolutionary perspective, proteins should be stable, but not too stable. And this is an example of proteins that become too stable. I've held you a long time here. It's 20 to 11. I would think about this, and then we'll meet at 11 sharp and continue. And I So I spoke a little bit, we spoke a little bit about misfolding of proteins, and there was one thing that none of you called me up. I just violated something very important here that I told you about last week. There were two fundamental people we talk about in the 1960s that said some very important things about proteins and native states. Who were those people? Amfinsen, and the other one was? So what did Amfinsen say? Well, not really. The sequence is structured to function, that's the central dogma. Amfinsen had a much more specific statement that he got the Nobel Prize for eventually. Folding can occur spontaneously, and if you formulate that in terms of free energy. So Amfinsen said strictly that the native states corresponds to the global minimum of free energy. It's free energy and it's global and the native state. So what is a native state? Actually, that's actually a pretty good definition, but I would argue, I would actually argue that it's wrong. So what is the native state? Native somehow means natural, right? So what is a natural state of a protein? The biologically active states, and I think that's what Amfinsen originally meant in the 1960s, right? So we're now saying that the biologically active state into which we will fold the protein should correspond, and that's a very biological concept. The really cool thing Amfinsen did, he translated this to a very physical concept that corresponds to the global minimum of free energy. But what have we just said here? So what's happened here that this would be the biologically active state, the native state, but that is not the global free energy minimum. So the global free energy minimum is some even deeper state, and this is not specifically for a prion, but what this could correspond to is that this could be the biologically native, the native state, the biologically active one. It's certainly a very low free energy state, but if you wait forever, there is a very high barrier that you might be able to get over and reach an even lower free energy state, which is bad because this is disease related. And this violates Amfinsen. So what we're now saying is that native states does not correspond necessarily correspond to the global free energy minimum, but the native state is kind of kinetically stable, as I said before we break, right? Normally, under the time scales we look at, if you don't eat brain, you would stay in this state. So for all intents and purposes in your body, this will appear to be the most stable state, just because it takes too long to go over to the wrong one. So today we frequently talk about folding funnels or something, that the native state is a, it's certainly a very, it's a local minimum in free energy. It's a very low free energy, but it's the lowest accessible state. There might be something even lower that we can't get to under normal circumstances. We ignore those. Now the question is how common this is going to be. Does it happen for 1 in 100 proteins, 1 in 1,000, 1 in 10,000 sequences? If you just randomly created sequences, how frequently do you think this would happen? We'll come back to that later on in the course. So rather than saying that you have a correct and an incorrect state, you can think of this as a protein that has two states, right? Both of them are really good. It's just that one happens to be slightly better than the other. So the normal notion is that a protein has one stable state. These proteins kind of have two stable states. It just happens that one of them is a bit bad. And it's going to be rare, but not impossible. So that brings us, we've studied both alpha helices and we've studied both beta sheets. But in particular, when it comes to predicting structure, I frequently talk about the unfolded state or the non-native state. So when it comes to understanding proteins in general, there is one more state that we have to understand a bit, and that's the state that is neither helix nor sheet, but really the coil or the unfolded state, the completely random state. And this is a bit complicated. What can you say about a completely random state? Well, if the free energy was, first, negative compared to what? Absolute free energies are difficult. So that depends on whether the reaction will happen or not. So we can't necessarily say something about the specific free energy of this state. But when I think of unfolded states, I frequently draw them this way. This is very bad. That's not how a protein is going to look like in solution. How many stretched out? This means that all the torsion angles had to be stretched out. There are very few states like that. Most states will rather look like something like the, I need to steal more pens. Most states would look like some piece of yarn or something that you just throw on the floor. If you throw a piece of yarn on the floor, the likelihood that it will be stretched out is zero. So one very important concept, both for proteins but even for DNA, is really what is the average end-to-end distance between chains? Can you think of something else you would like to use that for? So we use this a whole lot in size exclusion experiments, chromatography or something. So if you have a gel or something that has a very fine, some sort of pattern inside the gel, and if we now know what is the average size of our gel, that means that chains that are very long, they will get stuck in the gel, but chains that are smaller, they will go through the gel quicker, right? So in lots of cases, it's going to be important for us to, can I somehow relate the length of either my protein or a piece of DNA to how large it will be on average? And it turns out that this is a really complicated thing initially, and then it's going to turn out to be really simple. So if we forget about a protein would be super complicated with all our torsion angles and everything. But to keep things super simple, let's say that each amino acid is really a bead. It's a point. And then we assume that you can turn, so if we start at one amino acid here, and then I move to the next one, I can place the average distances between two amino acids is roughly the same. And you can calculate exactly what it is, but we can just say that that's some sort of length R or L. And the second you've moved from one amino acid to another, you can move any direction you want. So to first approximation, let's ignore the fact that you might overlap or something. If you work with vector analysis, this is actually easier. I know not all of you have. But if you start here and then you move all along this chain, you can say that you go from there to there. This is a vector H. And this vector H, you write it in fat, because that just means that in this case it's two dimensions. You could imagine it being three dimensions too. This is going to be a sum of the motion we have in the first amino acid and the second and the third, etc. And each of these is also a vector, so there are small arrows pointing. So we just sum up all these arrows. And then I want to calculate what is the average length if you go from the start to the end, because that's going to correspond to the end-to-end distance of either my protein. Well, I can calculate that too, right? That's going to be, the length here is going to be 8 squared. I will take the square root of it in a second. But that length corresponds to taking that sum, and I don't care how many residues I have here, and square the entire sum. And if you know your mathematical laws here, there are going to be two parts of this. First, you have, that means that every single term in this sum will have to be multiplied by every single term in the sum, right? So there's going to be one term here when I multiply each vector by itself, and then another large double sum when I multiply each vector in pairs when it's not the vector with itself. And that probably doesn't appear to make a whole lot of sense to you right now. But that means that in general, if this, what I had on the previous slide, this was just one specific conformation of the protein. In practice, the protein will move. So if I now take the average of this, it's going to be much easier. So the average, and the average here I denote with these big square brackets. There should be a bracket there too. That's then going to correspond to one part that comes from the average of the multiplying the vector's length with itself, and one part that the average of multiplying one vector with another. So right now, this is a super simple model. If I just have a, forget about residues, think of this as a mathematical sequence of beads where I have some sort of length between each bead, that's r, and then I can place each bead in any direction from the previous bead. You can think of this as a super simple model for protein or a super simple model for DNA. And the length r here, that could correspond to the distance between two amino acids or between two bases. But at this point, it's just a super simple model of a chain that's completely flexible. This is, of course, a horrible approximation because you can't turn any, in a protein, you can't place any amino acid any direction we want, right? They can't overlap or anything. But don't worry, well, I like simple models, remember? This average at first sight sounds really complicated, but if you have an average of a sum, you can take the average of the first term and then the average of the second term. And I can always move an average inside or outside the sum, that's the same. So I'm going to have one sum here that is really the sum of the squared lengths. And this doesn't really change because this is the length from one amino acid to the other. If you know the average length from one amino acid to the other, we know what that is. So that's just going to sum of the squared lengths of the amino acids. And then this one looks really complicated. Have you calculated products between vectors? So if you have one vector here and one vector there, that's the product here is going to correspond to the length of that vector multiplied by the length of that vector and the cosine between the two vectors here. But the direction here can be absolutely anything. What's the average of cosine of any angle? If you move the cosine over an entire period, it's zero. So if you randomly, because this basically, if I start at one point and I randomly move one unit in one direction, and then I randomly move one unit in another direction, on average I won't have moved at all. So we can forget about that entire term. So what this means that the average, the square average length of any type of this small self of any type of small chain, that goes as the square of each element multiplied by the number of elements. But here I had the square of it, right? So that if I want to calculate what is the average length of my entire chain point to point, then I should take the square root of this. You follow me? So that the average length of a chain from the beginning to the end, the average point-to-point distance will actually go as the square root of the number of residues. And that's why I don't really care that much about what the individual distance between two residues are. That's going to be one value in a protein, another value in a DNA chain. But on average, if you take a protein and makes it twice as large, it's going to be roughly 1.4 greater end-to-end distance. The average volume then is going to increase as, well, if that is the point-to-point distance, the average volume is going to be roughly that to the power of 3. Now, in practice, this is a horrible model because I kind of assumed that you can turn any amino acid in any direction. I also didn't account for the fact that they can overlap and everything. If you want to do this accurately, you can calculate some sort of effective distance from one amino acid to the other. And you can even try to assume that you can rotate around bonds, but they can't overlap. The book goes into some details there. But the only reason why I bring this up is that this won't change anything fundamentally. To first approximation, no matter what the segment size, the size of each segment is, it's still going to go as the square root of the number of residues. But that's pretty crappy, because what else did I ignore? So what happens if this residue starts to go back and overlap on the first residue? Will that be allowed? So the problem, a real chain had to be self-avoiding. How do you calculate that? That's going to be super complicated, right? Because if you have thousands of residues here, for each residue, you will now need to account that it should not overlap with the residue previously in space. And this goes back to some of the very first origins of computer calculations, self-avoiding chains. So sometimes in the roughly after World War II, people started to look a whole lot more into polymer chemistry. So polymers are much simpler than proteins, but I've alluded to already, proteins are polymers. So the whole lot of the modern knowledge about proteins, they really started out with simple polymers. And in particular, there is a group here that pretty much funded the entire field, which was Paul Flory. And Paul Flory really solved this problem. The really cool thing, he solved it analytically. There's a huge amount of mathematics involved in that. And rather saying that this goes as the number of residues, the square root of the number of residues, he showed that it's actually, the square root would be n to the power of 0.5. And he showed that this is a very complicated expression that evaluates to roughly n to the power of 0.588, and then lots of different digits there. So it's a very small correction factor. So Paul Flory got the Nobel Prize not just for this expression, but his entire formulation of modern polymer chemistry and polymer physics, how polymers behave. And Paul Flory's work later becomes some of the work that, in particular in Israel, people started working with proteins and understanding how proteins behave. And a particular group called Schneer-Lifson. Schneer-Lifson never got the Nobel Prize, but his disciples, Mike Levitt and Ari Warshall and Martin Karplus, they got the Nobel Prize just 3 years ago for much of their studies of simulations of proteins and everything. So there is a very continuous thread how people have worked all the way from physics over basic chemistry, understanding how chains behave, and then predicting proteins. So that almost completes the theory part. Or rather, it doesn't at all. This completes the heavy, boring mathematical part. But now we can start looking at real proteins. Because your advantage is that you can stand on the shoulder of these giants that have spent 50 to 70 years understanding how proteins behave. So if you start, this is a general protein, just the surface of a protein colored by the charges. And I think every small red cross here is a water oxygen. Now we can, of course, start looking more into that and consider the secondary structure elements and see how the different helices here are stabilized. Why do we have helices here? Why do we have beta sheets up here? We can go down even further. And rather than looking at those secondary structure elements, we can now start to say, so what are the electrostatic interactions between all these pairs? Why is this water stable in particular that location? And on this level, we can start to calculate each and every interaction between all the atoms in the systems. The difference is that this far we worked with paper and pen and tried to understand this conceptually, right? But it's not really more difficult to do it here. Rather than working, as some of you had questions about, when I've derived the stability of amino acids, I've talked about an amino acid, kind of an average amino acid with average properties, right? But that's just because for you, if we needed to do this derivation and take into account that amino acids had different properties, well, for the beta sheets, we would have 20 F beta, 20 delta F beta, and I would have had at least 20 U's, more than that, because there are two or three residues involved in each turn, right? So we would have had 400 U's. Then we would also need to take into account how amino acids interact with each other. It gets very complicated very quickly. But today we have computers for that. So once we have a computer, we can pretty much take every single position at every single atom here and just, you know what, let's just include all the atoms. What is the interaction of, let's see, that hydrogen bond? What are the Lennard-Jones interactions between those atoms? What are the electrostatics, bonds, angles, torsions, everything here? Because suddenly we can evaluate all the energies. You can ideally sample multiple states. And then all the things that we've now gone through on a conceptual level, you can just let the computer solve this and then make predictions about proteins. So this is partly very similar to bioinformatics in the sense that we use computers. The part where it's completely different from bioinformatics is, of course, here we rely on the laws of physics and chemistry rather than just genetic information. So in practice, what should you use? Both, yes. And there is not really, if it comes to predicting the structure of an entire protein, trying to do this from ab initio ground up, it's going to be insane. It will cost too much. It's not going to be accurate. On the other hand, any bioinformatics predictor you use, you don't really get the three-dimensional structure of that. The three-dimensional structure, you're picking some parts of it up from the PDB, but at the end of the day, you will still have to energy minimize it and get the structure to be stable. So I would argue that anybody building a predictor server or doing a project, in practice, you use both, but for slightly different reasons. So what I'm going to argue is that to understand this, for any type of system, we just really need to define what all the interactions in the systems are. And then we know what all the energy terms are. We don't know what the free energy term is because we don't have the entropy quite yet. So I'll get back to that in a second. These energy terms might look like complicated mathematics, but you have gone through almost all of these in the course. This is why I spoke about bonds. This is angles and the torsions. And these are just really simple mathematical forms, how we formulate them. Exactly what these are, just both of these are the simplest possible harmonic interactions. A torsion should somehow be periodic, so expressing that as a sequence of sine or cosine functions makes sense. But again, this is simpler than you think. There is not a single quantum mechanical part here. The improper torsion here, that just means that if you have a sequence of four atoms, occasionally you should say that these four atoms should be in a plane. We can describe that too with a simple harmonic interaction, and then we just need to have a letter to describe what our angle is. And just to make this a bit fancy, I can pick a fancy Greek letter. But this just means that, say, there is something here that depends on how four atoms are placed relative to each other. And then you need electrostatic interactions, and we have our Lennard-Jones interactions. So why don't I use quantum chemistry here? Yep. It would be expensive to calculate, but this comes back to the drunkard looking for his keys under the streetlight, and somebody is helping him to look for it, right? And say, why are you looking under the streetlight? Well, I dropped them over there, but I can't see over there, so I'm looking under the streetlight. It's completely irrelevant that it would be expensive to calculate if we're picking some bad form instead of the correct one, just because the correct one is expensive to calculate. So you're certainly right that it's expensive to calculate, but we also have to argue that we don't need it. In some cases, you do need it. The problem is what we don't have on this slide. So here we don't have the entropy, right? So the only way to account for entropy is that we're going to need to account for the fact that proteins do not just exist in one microstate. And the problem with quantum mechanics is exactly what you did in the lab on Monday. You assume that there is only one microstate of a structure. It's even worse than what you did on Monday. Because on Monday, you worked with multiple states in the lab at least, right? So quantum chemistry corresponds to picking just one of those states and calculating the energy perfectly in that one state, but ignoring all the other states. And that's pretty much everything we've gone through the last couple of days has to do with, for biomolecules, both the challenge and beauty of them is that there are many states, and we have to take the free energy into account. Otherwise, there's no interest in biology. Yes? Yeah, so I would say we cheat. This effect that atoms can't overlap each other, for instance, that's really a quantum mechanical effect, but we approximate this by parameters that we get from experiments instead. But the main thing here is that there are very few cases in proteins where bonds form and break during the folding of a protein. Disulfide bridges is the main exception. But in general, proteins, they stay, we have the bonds we have. It's just a matter that we need to place the protein in different conformations. And we need to understand how advantages or disadvantages all these different conformations are. And here's the problem. You could definitely imagine a state that you have some states that have the same energy, right? But in one state, the molecule is much more free to move. That state is going to correspond to more microstates. It will have higher entropy. You're not going to do a lab on this quite yet, but eventually we're going to start doing some labs on this. The problem if you're going to simulate things, it gets much more complicated because you can't just have something in free space. To simulate something, you're going to need to have water around it. How much water? Well, almost an infinite amount of water. If you want to simulate a test tube, you're going to have 10 to the power of 25 water molecules in the test tube. You can't simulate that in a computer. Completely hopeless. So in theory, you could imagine, could you take a small molecule and maybe have a sphere of water around it or something? You could that too, but then you would have a surface tension in the sphere, and that's also not good. So what you can actually do is that you can cheat a bit. So let's pretend that our system is a small box. And when this water molecule on the left there is about to escape on the left, what he really does is he comes in right again on the right. So you're essentially creating a periodic system. And if water is pretty good at screening molecules, right? Very high epsilon. So this molecule will probably not see his neighbor here or here. The water is going to, if you have just a little bit of water, the molecules won't see each other. So this makes it possible to put a small molecule in a computer simulation and calculate exactly how all the water will move. And a lot of the part about us understanding how hydrogen bonds form today, for instance, is actually from computer simulations. Because in a computer simulation, we can see how all these waters will orient around a small molecule here. Or forget about the small molecule. We can take an entire ion channel. You can see how this ion channel opens or closes, how the ions will go through the ion channel. These are scales that are much smaller, shorter than the experiment, so they're extremely limited. But it's pretty cool because you kind of have an atomic level computational microscope. So you can look at molecules, you can put a flag on every single atom and see exactly what the molecules do. So what's the danger with that? It looks really beautiful, right? You can have super fancy rendered images. It's a model. Prediction is quite, it's a model, right? Don't fall in love with your models because they could be wrong. And as beautiful as these things are, in particular if you have a DNA, you can make a super fancy system with DNA and everything. The danger is that it will look so good that it's obviously right. But what if you made a simple mistake in your model? So don't confuse your models with reality. They are amazingly useful, but they're not the same as reality. But the other part we're going to need to look into this, we're going to need to account for this entropy. And the cool thing is in a computer simulation, we can do that. We can't do it in plain quantum chemistry unless it's time dependent. But in a computer simulation, we can give this small chain a finite energy so that it has an energy corresponding to 300 Kelvin. And then they will, as you see here, it's moving around, testing a couple of different conformations, right? So what this molecule is now happily doing, your molecule is exploring the free energy landscape here. It's going to spend a lot of time in the blue parts here. It will spend very little time in the red parts here. And if you set this up correctly, it's going to sample a Boltzmann distribution. This is a key thing. What does a simulation do? I just said it, but I want all of you to think about it. So we'll come back to this in a second when it comes to what is that really that you're predicting or simulating? A simulation samples the Boltzmann distribution. You will pick states from your simulation that, again, within some statistical noise, the longer you simulate, the better a sample you're going to get of the Boltzmann distribution. That's all a that's all a simulation does for you, but it's also something amazing. Because, of course, if you can sample your entire space, right, that's the partition function. If you sample things well enough, you know everything about your system. And on the atomic level, I can calculate NMR parameters. I can calculate X-ray scattering. Since I know everything about the atoms, I can calculate how any experiment should behave and predict what the experiment should look like. So if I just have a computer that's powerful enough, this is amazingly fancy. And that's, of course, the other key here. Are computers fast enough? Or let me formulate this way. Were computers fast enough in the 1960s when people started to formulate things? So that's the horrible part, right? These things have taken decades to mature because people started doing this probably 40 years before computers were fast enough to do it. And for a long time, many of us felt that there is no way we will ever be able to do anything interesting. But computers get roughly twice as fast every 18 months. And there have been a lot of 18-month periods since 1960. So every decade, we gain about another factor of 100 here. There is no other computer laboratory technique or something that gets a factor 100 better every decade. So even since, there have been two decades since I was a PhD student. So we're about 10,000 times better than when I was a PhD student. And by the time you are my age, we're going to be a factor 10,000 better than we are today. And that's why it's worth to spend some time with these, right? These will gradually, these are things are gradually replacing lots of experiments. There are two things we're going to do, though. One, the first thing is that before we get to a simulation, a problem here is that the model you get, whether you get it, let's actually assume that you've done bioinformatics. So you have now built a model based on your bioinformatics predictor. And I hate to break it to you, but your bioinformatics predictors are not going to be perfect. So you will may have some, you will have made some small mistakes. You might have placed, say, whatever, small C, O, H, whatever. Let's just say that that hydrogen is, that oxygen is now very close to some other oxygen there. So that unfortunately that hydrogen bond is not paired up and these two atoms are just a bit too close to each other. Tiny amount, 0.1 angstrom or so. The only problem is that there are so many interactions in these systems. So when these atoms start to overlap and collide, the force between these atoms will be so large that your protein would basically explode if you try to simulate this. So we somehow need to fix up all the errors in proteins. And this, any predictor you have used, the predictor has done this internally. So to be able to start to simulate, you don't want to start out in that really horrible transition state where you should ever be. You want to be at a normal state that you would expect to see at room temperature. We call this, what we simply call that, this is energy minimization. It's a really stupid name. Because energy minimization would really correspond to be that we would like to find the absolutely lowest energy. We don't care about the lowest energy. Why don't we care about the lowest energy? So if go back to this, shouldn't the lowest energy be the native state? I'll ask that again. What is the native state? The lowest? No, is it the lowest energy or something else? If we're not sloppy with our definitions? Free energy, right? So energy and free energy is not the same. The only thing I can calculate is the potential energy. I can't calculate the free energy. So worrying about finding the lowest energy, that's just worrying about finding the lowest for half of your equation. Completely irrelevant. But the problem is that I don't want the, this is not really energy minimization. A proper name for this should be energy maximum avoidance. I don't want to be in the part, if you're going to simulate my walk, a bad initial condition is to place me in the middle of the wall because it's not a realistic state. So we need to get away from these really horrible states. There is a whole range of fancy algorithms you can use for that in mathematics. In practice, we don't really care because we don't want the best possible minimum. We just want to avoid the maximum. So if I put you in the Alps and I tell you that you should not be at the peak of a hill, what do you start doing? Yes, you go downhill. So that's actually exactly what we're going to do here too. So if you start anywhere you are here, you check and what is the direction where I'm going most downhill? That's the gradient. Take a step in that direction. Once you've taken a step in that direction, look around. Which one is the direction that to keep going downhill? As long as you go downhill, you will keep going downhill. You will only reach a local minimum, but it's going to be better than where you started. Yes? Exactly. It's the same thing. And the only way to find a global minimum would be to test every single local minimum. That's a super hard problem, and it's a problem we're not interested in. I just want to avoid the really bad. There are a bunch of algorithms that you can use to do this, but this is just a mathematical formulation of exactly what you said. I start at any random point, and then I determine in what direction does the gradient point. So what direction is the most steepest downhill? That would be that arrow. Then I take an arbitrary step here, and how long this step is, well, that's up to you. You can let the computer decide it or just pick a constant step. Now I'm here, and then I do exactly the same thing, and in that case, pointing downhill would mean going in that direction. And then I take a step in that direction. And normally you let the step length be proportional to how sharp it's pointing downhill. So if we're going a lot downhill, I can take longer steps. And this will eventually lead you to a local minimum. And by eventually here means that today we spend a couple of minutes on this, and then we're happy, and then we interrupt it, because I don't care about reaching the minimum. I just don't want to be at the maximum. Yo, today's first pen dropped. What do you think this does to a structure? Did you just see this moving? Hardly right. I'll show it to you again. So here's where we start from. This is a structure that I actually got from the protein data bank, but it could have been from a predictor or two. Like 3, 2, 1, 0, minimize. You hardly change it at all, right? There are some side chains that move a little bit. You might be packing things a little bit. I think you ended up extending the secondary structure just so slightly, but this doesn't change the protein at all. And that's why all your predictors tend to do this, so that you have a reasonable starting state. So the whole point here is that you change the coordinates by a fraction like an angstrom. These changes are so small that you can't really... This, both the initial and the end state here, I bet they roughly both have... Both the initial and end state I showed you here are likely just as compatible with the experiment. You can't tell which one of them is closer to the experiment. So you fix up local mistakes with energy minimization. The reason why I'm telling you this is something you're going to be doing either in bioinformatics predictors or in simulation. You do this a lot. And what you do is that if you start from the red ones here, the red one here is you start from a structure that have been a bit distorted, so that there is further, you have an entire distribution that zero here would mean the native state. And if you start to minimize them, you move them all just a little bit closer to the native state, but you won't be able to get all the way there. Why can't I get all the way to a native state just by energy minimization? That's the most important thing. First, we have tons of barriers, right? And I can never, going across a barrier would at some point mean going uphill. I can't do that to energy minimization. What's the other reason? That's what you just told me a couple of, well, 2-3 slides ago. What am I minimizing here? Energy. And the native state is defined by the minimum is in free energy. So I can't get a minimum in free energy by minimizing the energy, no matter how much computational power I throw at it. And that's why we're going to need the simulation, right? Because what the simulation will do, that will sample the entire phase space. As part of the phase space, phase space is just a physicist's way of saying every possible conformation and every possible velocity of atoms. It samples all the conformations that are possible. Now, you're going to spend most of the time there in the very low parts of free energy, and you're going to spend less time in the high parts of free energy. Why? So what did you find out in the lab on Monday? Bjorn told me that at least 17 of you handed in the report by yesterday evening, so that I think you've done it. What did you find in the lab? Where do you spend the most time? Yep. In the lowest energy states. Now, of course, on Monday you cheated because that was only energy, not free energy. This afternoon you're going to do it for free energy. And you're going to account for the fact that say that. So it's not just a postulate that a computer simulation will tell you the truth. The reason why we know that as long as we just sample this according to correct laws of physics, most of the time we will spend in the lowest free energy states. But the cool thing in a simulation, you're not just going to get the lowest energy. You will actually see the protein move. And if you somehow sample higher free energy states, you will see that. So then we're in an amazingly beautiful world, right? Assuming that you had a computer that was infinitely fast, and then you just take the exact structure of the protein from the protein data bank, or a new structure, and then you could simulate exactly how the protein would move, right? Do you see any problems with this? So let's make a very simple simulation here. Anytime you're going to simulate anything or predict a motion, what does that depend on? You have made some assumptions, right? So we certainly have a model how our interactions are. So we need to hope that all these energy terms we have are good enough in some way. Let's assume they are. Let's assume we have a perfect, if we have an infinitely fast computer, you could assume that we did this with quantum mechanics. But there is something else that matters, the initial states, right? So this is a pendulum. This is kind of, well, simpler version of pendulum. If this is my initial state, what's going to happen? So in this, the coordinate of the pendulum is that it can move here, right? If this is the initial state, the coordinate is there, nothing much is going to happen. It's also, you can also say that this is before my simulation happens. So I could also say that I start here, but I actually have given it the velocity. So then it will, so there are two things that matter, the initial coordinates and the initial velocities. So just knowing the coordinates is not enough. You also need to know the velocities. So in what database do you find the velocities of a protein? You don't. So that's the other problem. In general, if a large system with lots of particles, we can, of course, approximate the velocities. How can you approximate velocities of a protein? So the energy, any molecule will have some kinetic energy, right? And that's the mass of each particle multiplied velocity squared divided by 2. And then you sum up this overall ice in the system. And we know that that should correspond to temperature, right? So at 300 Kelvin, there will be a random distribution of velocities. And this is what you call the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution in physics. But if we know, say, at 300 Kelvin, I can assign this random distribution of velocities to a particle. So I can pretty much give a protein random velocities. But this leads to another problem that I can't just randomly give a protein velocities, right? Because that, depending on velocities I would give it, it would go in different directions. Yes? So how would you raise the temperature in a simulation? By adding energy, right? And that too would have to be random. So the problem, you can't know the velocities of a protein. I'm going to make a small mistake here. I'm going to make a small experiment here. I'm going to touch one of you. No, you didn't die. Biology, in general, any type of simulation, if I picked a different starting condition for my pendulum, it would move in a completely different direction. And for most physical systems, this is super complicated. Most physical systems are chaotic. If you make a minimal change, this is the Lorentz attractor. If you make a minimal, normally this particles here, they move between these two halves of a mathematical expression. But if you make a minimum change in either the position or the velocity, it's going to be impossible to predict after a couple of turns how it will move. And this is what has led to all these popular science about that the strokes of a butterfly in one part of the world is going to create a hurricane in another part of the world. I have no idea if they've ever been able to prove that. But the point is that infinitesimally small differences in initial conditions will eventually lead to large deviations. To make this even worse, if you're working with quantum mechanics, you can prove with the Heisenberg uncertainty principle that it's impossible to know both the position and velocity exactly at the same time. So what physics is basically telling you that it's impossible to predict the future. That's a bit of a bummer. And also, you didn't die here, and you laughed at it. That was a really dangerous experiment, right? Because you all instinctively know that biological systems are stable, and minimal. So essentially what we tried to do here, we altered the state, the position and velocity of some of your atoms a bit. It should be impossible to predict what would have happened. So what is that we're missing here? probabilities, right? So this comes down to the Boltzmann distribution. If you're looking at the solubility of a small compound in a test tube, the exact conformation of that molecule is not important, because we're looking at average properties. And everything in physics, and therefore also chemistry and biology, has to do with what you call an ensemble property. This is just really a fancy word for average. So an ensemble of a molecule is that this small molecule moving over different parts in phase space. Well, if you do a measurement, the whole point, you don't just have one structure. As you've seen in the lab, you can have a range of different structures, and the population in different states will depend on the energy. And if I now make a measurement, I might have 90% of my measurement might come from one state, 5% from a second, 3% from a third, and then lots of other small states. So any measurement you make in the lab is going to be an average of all the observations you have in the entire ensemble. In most cases, this will mean that virtually everything you see are going to come from some low-level regions in the free energy, and you're hardly going to get any contribution at all from the high-lying regions. But hardly is not exactly the same as zero. Formally, every single point for every single possible conformation of your protein or molecule contributes just a little bit. But in practice, you're going to have 99.99% from this part. So to simplify our lives, we can ignore everything else. But that means that anything you do, any way your molecules interact, will be an average property. And the point is, when I touch your hand, is that technically the molecules in your body ended up taking a slightly different part in phase space here. I need to have a tether of this. But of course, the average sampling of your states didn't change. You still stand 99.99% in the lower level states, right? So any measurement, any low level, and this means that nature effectively dampens out all these small fluctuations. It's not the path of individual atoms that matter. And this is also why simulations work. I have no idea how many even professors think that that a simulation predicts the path atoms take. You can't predict the motions of atoms. What simulations do is that they sample parts. So this is a small helix, actually, I think, in water. I'm just looping this around. But the point is, it's not even relevant to predict how the individual water molecules move here, right? But the average properties in them, the average number of hydrogen bonds, the average interactions with these proteins, that is important. And that we can measure in excellent ways in a simulation, even if I don't know what the exact initial velocities were. What's going to happen for these waters, if I give them random velocities, roughly 5 to 10 picoseconds later, the water will have forgotten that velocity. Now, of course, if I assign a new set of velocities, I'm not going to get exactly the same simulation, but the average properties in the simulation will be the same. The things I can measure and the things that would correspond to things I could measure in the lab, they would be the same. For instance, the number of hydrogen bonds. But this means there are actually a number of ways you could do a simulation, conceivably. Because if we want to take multiple states into account, I'm going to need to find a way to move from one state to another one, right? That's not an easy problem. The only thing that we have to demand is that we need to fulfill the Boltzmann distribution. I can't randomly pick states out of my back pocket. You have to obey the laws of the Boltzmann distribution. In particular, this detailed balance, that the probability of moving between states should still maintain the Boltzmann distribution. That's what you've been doing in the lab on Monday, and that's what you're going to do today. So you just create a very simple way that if you are in one state, predict how likely it's going to be to move to another state. And in physics, you typically call that a Monte Carlo simulation. You just move between states in some sort of intelligent fashion. If each move fulfills the Boltzmann distribution, the entire distribution you get is also going to fulfill the Boltzmann distribution. The reason why we use that in the labs is that it's dirt simple and it's just one line of code. You could imagine the problem if you were to do that for a large protein with tens of thousands of residues and everything. If you randomly tried to move the protein to another conformation, what would happen on average? It would bump into itself, right? Or it would bump into water. If you randomly tried to pick another conformation of the protein, on average, you would always bump into something else. Because most conformations are not allowed. There are very few allowed conformations. So it turns out that for proteins and large molecules, the best way of doing this is actually just to solve Newton's equations of motions. We know what the potential is, and then I can just take the gradient of the potential to calculate which direction would you like to move in, what are the forces, and then I calculate, well, the forces corresponds to acceleration, acceleration corresponds to change in velocities, and then I can keep moving atoms a little bit. So then it ends up looking exactly as if I'm actually simulating the exact motions of particles. So that leads to the other part that is completely dominant in how you actually simulate proteins or other molecules today. Yes, you had a question.
In the previous slide, you had something stochastic or Brownian dynamics.
I'll come to that in a second.
In the end, do they really matter because you're only taking the average of the whole picture?
Yeah. So normally, what I'm arguing is that one really good way of generating states that corresponds to the Boltzmann distribution is simply to calculate for each particle exactly how it would like to move based on the forces around you. Now, there are a couple of ways we can modify that. I can allow a little bit of noise, or I can allow noise either in the velocities or noise in the forces. So this is just ways of, you can actually use this as a way to control your temperature, for instance. If you're adding a bit of noise in all your velocities to make sure that you have an average velocity that corresponds to 300 Kelvin, these are just ways you can modify the dynamics. And this is simple. This is much simpler. Now that you understand the statistical mechanics, this is a much simpler way than anything else we've done. So all I want to do is, given the initial coordinates and velocities or something, I would like to calculate how it moves. We are well aware that there are errors in this, but as long as the errors are small over reasonably long parts and these parts are realistic, I should get good average properties of the atoms. So the way I calculate these atoms is to use some high school mathematics. First is Newton's first law. If I know where all my atoms are, I can calculate the potential. And again, in physics, the force on anything is just the derivative of the potential with respect to position. There are going to be lots of atoms here. If you have 10,000 atoms, there might be 10,000 squared interactions. This is why you're going to need a computer. So it's an extremely complicated force to calculate on every atom. But if I know what the force in every atom is, I definitely know what the mass of every atom is, then I can calculate what is the acceleration on every single atom. And if I know what the acceleration is, well, the acceleration is the derivative of velocity with respect to time, right? So if I know how the velocity changes, I can calculate, well, that should change by, say, 1 meter per second per second. Well, take a small time, and then I can calculate for one step how much should the velocity change. Velocity, though, that's the derivative of position with respect to time. So then I can do the same thing again. Well, over this step, how much did my position change? Now you just moved all your atoms by a tiny bit. Because you're using Newton's law here, this is frequently called Newton's equations of motion. Simple classical mechanics. You can define this slightly fancier with partial derivatives and gradients, but this is telling you exactly the same thing. Force is mass times acceleration, and this force you get from the derivative of the potential with respect to all the particle positions. This is going to be impossible to calculate manually, but trivial for a computer. And what you get from this is that, as a function of time, you're going to get different positions from your atoms. So let's do this. The potential is the one I showed you before. You know all these interactions. And then we're having a small molecule, that water molecule there, and he's taking steps. So these steps have to be in the ballpark of femtoseconds. I know, it's amazing. We're understanding so much biology from this, right? It tells you everything about our proteins fold. It tells you absolutely nothing about proteins fold. This poor water molecule didn't even rotate 180 degrees in 100 femtoseconds. And this is where people were in the 1960s when they started out with this. The cool thing today, even on a laptop, this is a rendered movie, but this is roughly how fast I could calculate this in real time on a laptop. Now I'm actually showing all the neighbors of that water molecule at room temperature. So in a couple of minutes on a laptop, I can calculate a few picoseconds of real time. So here you're seeing how all the waters are making and breaking hydrogen bonds. Just using some very simple parameters from water, I can predict the density correctly, I can predict the viscosity, I can predict the diffusion coefficients, I could calculate what the energy of water is, I could predict the phase transition of water. That's still a bit boring because this is still physics, or maybe physics borderline chemistry. It's definitely not biochemistry. But again, this was in less than 1 minute on a laptop. People would have killed for this in the 1960s. And with supercomputers or large things, you can calculate how a large protein folds. So when I was a little bit older than you are, in the late 1990s, Peter Coleman, they used something like 6 months of supercomputing time, and they were able to fold this protein called the villain headpiece. And this was one of those game changes, because prior to that, we weren't even sure whether it's ever going to be possible to fold proteins. But they could actually fold this protein in a computer. It's a real protein, roughly 30 residues. But you can imagine how much it costs to use 6 months of supercomputing time on one of the largest computers in the world, right? So when I was a postdoc at Stanford, we started to play around with other ways of doing this. The problem with doing this, the reason why you need a supercomputer for this, sorry, I'm going to run over just 3-4 minutes today so I can finish the slides here. The reason why you need a supercomputing for this is that you need to take first one step, and then the second step, and then the third step, and then the fourth step, and you need to repeat this like a couple of billion times. But do I really need to do it that way? Because I'm not simulating the motion of one protein, right? I'm sampling states from a distribution. Couldn't I do this with more simulations? You could, right? Because you could have you can give them initial velocities, and instead of having one simulation, you could have two simulations sample different parts in parallel, and then they can run on different computers. Then you're gonna need two supercomputers. Or you could have three simulations if you have three supercomputers. The problem is that supercomputers get larger all the time, but it's virtually impossible to get the simulation to scale to all of them. So instead of running this on one supercomputer, could you imagine using 10,000 small computers and letting them all run a very short simulation? So this is something we've been doing for 15 years as part of a project called Folding at Home. So we use distributed computing, screensavers, and send out a small piece of a protein to each and every one worldwide. This is a protein called BBA5 that was designed to be super stable and form a small alpha helix and two beta strands, so beta, beta, alpha. This is roughly 400 atoms in the protein. The problem is that you can't fold the protein in vacuum, so we're going to need to add something like 10,000 atoms or 12,000 atoms of water. So we're mostly simulating water and a tiny bit of protein in it. And then you run this on 10,000 computers. And of those 10,000 computers, in a handful of cases, you see the protein. This is it. You're going to see an alpha helix forming soon here. You see that? You formed an alpha helix there. And it was a pretty rapid collective transition. This is actually a beta sheet, but it's formed in the wrong way. And somewhere around 40 nanoseconds, you're going to see this turn around and break. And then it will form in the right turn. You see, now we're losing the beta sheet. And now we're going to form the beta sheet in the right way. And then we cheat a bit and stop the clock when we just happen to fly by the native state. This only happens in one simulation of 1,000. Because in practice, this would take in the ballpark of 10 microseconds for it to happen. So on average, it won't happen. But in a few simulations, we will see it happening. And that's exactly because we're sampling things from a Boltzmann distribution. We can do far fancier things than this today, and you can actually use this to predict binding, and we're going to come back to that later on in the course. But the point here is that there is no such thing as a trajectory is not a prediction, but a trajectory is really a sample from these distributions. And that's the one thing that you're going to use later on in the course, because you're going to be running simulations. There are a bunch of other questions that I won't go into detail here, but that we will come back to later on. If you want to simulate, the cool thing with this is that we can actually simulate much more realistic things. But the realistic things also gives you a bit of problem. And a physicist would put something in an isolated system. But in an isolated system, you don't exchange, the temperature is not constant. So at some point, the potential energy goes down because we reach a more stable system. the kinetic energy would start to go up, so I would heat the protein. So I'm going to need to control, I usually want to simulate something at a fixed temperature, say 300 Kelvin. I usually want to stay at room temperature, lab normal pressure, 1 bar, unless you want to simulate an atomic bomb, which is actually legal on most supercomputers. US has export controls, and as part of these export controls, we promise not to simulate pressures higher than a megabar or something. Maybe would you allow the salt concentrations to change? Then you're going to need to add or remove atoms. So there are quite a lot of complicated physical rules of the simulation that you would need to find a way to do. And just as a simple example, you can control temperature. The way you control temperature is by adjusting the velocities of the atoms to make sure that these distributions correspond to 300 Kelvin. So it's certainly possible to make these simulations match experiment very closely. And the cool part here, in contrast to quantum mechanics, we can definitely simulate things under conditions that should correspond exactly to an X-ray crystal or exactly a cryo-EM experiment. And now you can make a simulation and predict what are the experimental observables you would expect to see in the experiments. And then you start having a beautiful connection between theory and experiment again. But this brings me to the last slide here. You would be surprised. All this is based on statistical mechanics that we've gone through. So what's the first part of that word? Statistical. Everything here builds upon statistics and the Boltzmann distribution. Just because you see something in a simulation doesn't mean that it's true. Because you're now looking at the scale of individual atoms, and just now and then you will have a high energy. So everything in the simulations, you need to see it multiple times and you need to make proper statistics about this. And this is the part that we're going to need to be a little bit careful about. But as long as we can solve that, it's going to be an extremely powerful way to make predictions, accurate predictions about real systems. We can calculate how much it costs to solve a compound. Well, could you imagine that could be useful? Why on earth is it useful to be able to calculate how soluble a compound is? Drugs, right? Couldn't you just go into the lab and measure how soluble the compound is? So drug compounds need to be reasonably soluble, otherwise you can't administer them. You can certainly measure it in the lab, so why don't we do that? No, I would say that it's trivial to control the parameters in the lab. But the problem is you're going to need to start by making the compound. And these compounds are typically super complicated organic molecules. And at this point, I don't yet know what compound I want, right? I would like to design a good compound. So you're going to have people coming up with 10,000 new compounds per week in the computer, candidate compounds. You can synthesize them, you can order them, and they will cost like $50,000 per compound. If you go to your boss and say, boss, I just ordered 10,000 compounds for $50,000 each, the next word is going to be you're fired. And they will take 4 weeks to produce them, right? But if you can give this to a computer and overnight calculate the solubility and say, well, only 100 of these are soluble, those are the 100 you should order. So that computers are not going to be as accurate in the lab, but the advantage of computers are cheap and fast. So we're increasingly using computers to screen properties like this. You're going to do these later on in the lab, so I won't go through exactly how to run a simulation. And we're going to spend a whole lot more time talking about this. But just the study questions here, so that we're kind of finishing up the hard part of the mathematics at least, and we're gradually moving over now to real biomolecules, how we can handle them in the computers. Tomorrow I'm going to be in Swindon, actually, to give a lecture. But on Friday, we're going to be looking at real protein structure. But now we will understand a little bit how to treat that protein structure.